जी, तो जो बताया धीरता है ना, परसिवियरेंस, वो चाहिए।
जी
ठीक है सुनीता जी, बहुत बढ़िया। अब
जी
हम
ठीक
लोग
है।
की बात कर लेते हैं पेशेंट की। सो वेलकम एवरीबॉडी टू दिस सेशन ऑन UHV2। सो टुडे वील टॉक अबाउट द बिहेवियर, द वर्क एंड पार्टिसिपेशन एंड ऑल्सो अबाउट द अनडिवाइडेड सोसाइटी, द यूनिवर्सल ह्यूमन ऑर्डर एंड ह्यूमन कंडीशन। सो दिस इज द कंपोनेंट 3.4 टू 3.9 of what we have been talking about the resolution, the all-encompassing resolution. So today's session we will try to look briefly into these six aspects of all-encompassing resolution. We have already seen, looked into the first three aspects, the right understanding, the wisdom and the science. And now in the light of that, we want to look into this remaining six aspects, starting from behavior to human tradition. So if you remember, this is the main content that we are looking into, exploring into. Number one is that human desire is for continuous happiness, which is the need of the self. And this continuous happiness is ensured by way of right understanding, right feeling and right thought, which are the activity of the self. And this right feeling and right thought is what we are calling as resolution. And then we saw that this resolution, this right understanding, right feeling, calls for having the clarity of all aspects of human living, all aspects of human existence. And then we formulated these nine aspects which relate to human existence for our exploration. So these are the nine aspects which we can identify in our existence, in the human existence. And the resolution has to do with the clarity in all aspects of human existence. Therefore, we need to have clarity about all these nine aspects. So throughout the course, if you see now, we have been trying to clarify, trying to explore, investigate into each of these aspects. So first we have investigated into right understanding, you know, in a very detailed manner. So the major part of the course has to do with this right understanding, understanding of human being and existence and the human conduct. With that understanding, we looked into this wisdom, which is one of the important aspects of human existence. So right understanding is the most important aspect of human existence. Then wisdom is the next, and then science is the third aspect. And under that science, we talked about science of behavior, science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. Now, we want to expand a little, about the behavior, the work, the participation in the larger order, which is an outcome of the science of behavior, science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. So we'll try to explore into this in this session. And then we'll also try to explain into this outcome of this behavior, work, and participation in the larger order in the world outside, in terms of undivided human society, the universal human order, and the human tradition, in which human goal is fulfilled generation after generation. So we'll try to look into this Now, as I said, when we're talking about science, we talked about science of behavior, science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. And in that context, we did define behavior, work, and participation in the larger order. So there is not much to define stress or investigate stress, but what we are going to do in this is that bring out about your attention, bring your attention towards the fact that when we are talking about behavior, work, and participation in the larger order, in UHB1, our emphasis is different. When we are talking about the same thing, this behavior, work, and participation in the larger order, the basic reality is same. So we are trying to understand that. But now we have improved. So the basic reality that we are seeing, like behavior, work, participation in the larger order, is the same, but we have improved in the process, and therefore our emphasis is now different. Our emphasis is different. So when we talk about behavior in UHB1, it is different, you know, because our emphasis is different. Behavior as a reality is the same. Similarly, when we are talking about work in UHB1, the emphasis is different. When we are talking about the same work in UHB2, our emphasis is different. So that is what we want to bring about, bring out in this session. So I've written this down. We have already discussed about this behavior, work, and participation in UHB1. And also in the last session on science of behavior, work, and participation. However, we recall that these things, these realities that we talked about, we'll recall this with some discussion on change of emphasis that we have in mind in UHB1 and now. So what was the emphasis in UHB1 and what is the emphasis now? That has changed. So we'll try to recall these realities, behavior, work, and so on, with this in mind that we will see what is the emphasis before and what is the emphasis now. This change on emphasis has taken place because we have changed. We the perceiver, we the knower, the self has changed. So there is development in the self, and therefore my perception about the same reality has changed. So that we want to understand. So what we mean by change of emphasis is that when we were talking about these in UHB1, these means behavior, work, and so on, we started from individual human being and slowly expanded to family, society, nature, and finally existence. So this is what we were doing. We started looking at these realities like behavior, like work, from the point of an individual, in the context of an individual. Then expanded it to the context of a family, context of a society, and finally to the context of nature and existence. That is what we try to do there. So we said behavior is important for me as an individual. And if it is important, this relationship is important. If you remember the first session, we said not only physical facility, but relationship is also important. Behavior is also important. And then we said that when we talk about behavior, it has to do with the behavior in the family. our behavior in the family, you know, should be defined, and should be understood, and it should be ensured, you know, it should be improved. And when we are talking about the family, probably we didn't have much idea about the society, you know, and what we have to do at the level of society. But then slowly we expanded into society and nature and so on. But when we have this realization of coexistence, that is, we have moved up to the realization of coexistence through contemplation, understanding of relationship and harmony, right? When we have moved up to realization of coexistence, and from there we are looking at these things, you know, this means behavior and work. We have to start from existence and from there come down to nature, society, family, and lastly the individual. So this is the change of perspective, that we started with individual and moved up to existence. Now we are going to start with existence and move down to the individual, to the family, to the individual. And this matters a lot. Right? So that we want to, you know, bring to your notice for your investigation. So this is some, you know, description about my self-evaluation, evolution. That I have evolved in the process. I have changed while going through the process in UHB1 and now in UHB2. So if I have changed, my emphasis will change. Even when I am seeing the same reality of behavior, my emphasis will change. Even when I am seeing the same reality of work, my emphasis will change depending upon where I am. Where I am in this process of self-evolution. So we have already talked about this, so I am not going to explain much. But important thing is this transformation, right? From animal consciousness to human consciousness. And this transformation is demarcated by having this activity of contemplation. So till we have this activity of contemplation, at least, most of our imagination is guided by preconditioning and sensation. Right? That is one stage. But when we are awakened to this contemplation, when we are active at the level of contemplation and we can see the relationship and the feelings in relationship, my participation in relationship, then my desire starts getting guided by this, you know, contemplation, or what we have seen at the level of contemplation, and that is what we were calling as wisdom. So my desire now is guided by this wisdom, this, you know, identification of human goal, human values. Then the situation is different. So that is the place where this transformation is taking place, from animal consciousness to human consciousness. And once this transformation has started, and if I am working on myself, then from contemplation I will be able to move to understanding, and from there I will be able to move to realization of coexistence. So this is the process of self-evolution. And when we have evolved up to this realization of coexistence, then what will be our perspective about behavior, about work, about participation in the larger order? That is what we want to see briefly. These are some details which you can look at. I will not elaborate much on them. But I can just mention that when I am working only at the level of imagination, being guided by the conditioning and sensation, my situation of behavior, work, and participation, it looks like this. So in my behavior, sometime I am in a state of happiness and giving happiness to the other. but mostly I am in a state of unhappiness and causing unhappiness to others. My work is such that sometime I am able to ensure prosperity for myself and for rest of nature. But mostly I feel deprived and deprived in nature, the other human being. Similarly, when it comes to my participation, sometime I am contributing to the human order. And mostly either I am passive or I am the cause of disorder. With contemplation, my behavior has changed, has improved. So now at the level of behavior, I am better. So mostly happiness, but sometime unhappiness. If I am able to see the relationship at the level of contemplation with human being, this is what will happen at the level of behavior. At the level of work, if I have not seen my participation, my relationship with the rest of nature, then I may still continue with that sometime prosperity and most of the time deprivation. But if I have this clarity about my relationship with rest of nature, then I will tend to ensure prosperity most of the time. But still there may be some time when I am contributing to deprivation. But it comes to participation, sometime I am contributing to order, and most of the time I might be passive or leading to disorder. But when I am having this understanding of harmony in nature, then these three things will happen. I am mostly in a state of happiness and contributing in happiness. We are mostly prosperous, feeling prosperity and working for the prosperity of others. And mostly contributing to order. But still there are traces, sometimes traces of unhappiness, some traces of deprivation, and sometimes I am passive. But when I have the realization of coexistence, when I can see that the whole existence is in the form of coexistence, right? And as a result, the whole nature, every unit of nature is in harmony. And as a result, every unit is related to every other unit in a mutually fulfilling manner. Then this thing will happen. I will have the behavior in which there is mutual, I am in a state of continuous happiness myself, and I am working for the happiness of the other. My work is such that I always have this feeling of prosperity, and I'm helping. I'm willing to help the others for prosperity. Of course, I'm able to take care of the nature, its preservation. And my participation is such that I'm always contributing to others. So this is the way I will look at the behavior, the work, the participation in the larger order. So as far as the external reality of behavior and work is concerned, participation is concerned, this reality is same, but depending upon my state of the self, my evolution of the self, I will be able to respond, first perceive these things differently, and therefore respond differently. So let us look at that. So now when we look at the behavior, this behavior, which is the recognition of human-human relationship, its fulfillment and evaluation leading to mutual happiness, that is justice, from family to world family, leading to undivided society. This is what is the behavior that we have defined. Right? This reality remains the same, but when we have the realization of coexistence, and from there we are looking at behavior, we will see the behavior in the context of undivided society. That is in the context of world family. And from there we'll come down to society and finally the family. As a result, we start from feeling of love for all, each and every unit in nature, and then come down to affection for any particular member of the family or any particular unit in nature. So this is very important. That now, even when I am talking about or thinking of my affection, feeling of affection for any particular individual, any particular member of the family, at the background of it, I have this feeling of love, feeling of being related to all. Very important. So think on this, reflect on this, a very important difference, that now when I'm talking about affection with any particular individual, right, I have at the back of my mind, I have at the background my feeling of love, that is feeling of being related to all, each and every unit in nature. And this is going to make all the difference. So we are saying this is what we did while talking about feelings in relationship in the last session. That is, we started with feeling of love and saw that every other feeling is a specific application. For example, feeling of affection. If you remember, in HB1, we had started with trust, respect, affection, and so on. And finally, we concluded with the feeling of love. But in the last session, we started with the feeling of love and tried to see that every other expression or every other feeling in the relationship is an expression of this feeling of love in specific conditions. So love is there at the base with the realization of coexistence. We have the feeling of being related to all. That is love, and with that we have the responsibility to fulfill that relationship, and that is compassion. With this compassion, when I look outside, right, I may be in immediate contact with some people, so I will ensure the fulfillment of my relationship with those people. But when I am ensuring the fulfillment with those people, for example, this feeling of affection, then I have this at the back of my mind that I am related to all. And if that is there, then let's see. So we will see the relationship and feeling in the context of undivided society, and this makes all the difference. And what is that difference? Because now when I'm seeing relationship with one individual, it cannot violate relationship with any other individual. This is important. So when I have this feeling of love at the base, at the background, then when I'm identifying my relationship with my family member, let's say, right, and I'm trying to fulfill my relationship, my responsive feeling towards that individual, I will not violate this feeling of affection for anybody else, because at the back I can see that I am related to all. This is important. Where is this can happen when we are starting from the individual? This we can see in our day-to-day behavior. So if we are starting with behavior in the family, and you are trying to expand up to the world family, it is likely that when you are trying to fulfill this relationship of affection with one of your family members, you might violate your relationship with other human beings. And this we can see that today, in the name of facilitating our family members, nurturing our family member, we are willing to exploit others. so much of corruption is because we have over-evaluation of our family members and under-evaluation for the other members of the society. So we are willing to exploit the other members of the society for the purpose of serving the or fulfilling the commitment of my affection to the family member. So this is the shift. This is the shift. The reality of behavior is the same, but my perception has become different. Parenthesis has become different. And that makes all the difference. So what we would say in a sense is that now when you look at this, you know, in things in the context of the whole existence, the whole nature, the whole society, then the focus will be on the existence as a whole, nature as a whole, and humanity as a whole. Even when I am working with one individual or one particular thing in nature, my emphasis is, or my background is always having this feeling of relationship with every unit in nature, with every human being, and with every unit in the rest of nature. With that perspective, I will see the behavior and respond in my behavior. And that will make all the difference, as we have just mentioned. So we'll have this, you know, many questions on this, because it's a major shift that we are talking about. And whole lot of process will be involved. You know. So there will be many questions, but we'll take them up at the end of the session. So these are the details that we have talked about regarding behaviors. I'm not going to, you know, detail discussion of it. Then we have work. After behavior, we have this work 3.5. And when we look at the work, again, we have, you know, the definitions available: recognition of human rest of nature relationship, its fulfillment and evaluation leading to mutual enrichment. So work has to do with my relationship with rest of nature. So when I can identify my relationship with rest of nature, then I work for the fulfillment of it, right, and evaluate it. As a result, there'll be in mutual enrichment in the nature. Mutual enrichment in the nature. That is what we are calling as work. Now, what we are saying is that with this realization of coexistence, and from there we are looking down at work, we will see the work in the context of nature as a whole. And from there, we will come down to work with nature in the village, and finally work with nature in and around the family. So this is interesting, that when I'm working in the family and when I'm doing some work with the rest of nature, I may be concerned only about the immediate nature, immediate surrounding, without the realization of coexistence, without the understanding of harmony, contemplation of relationship. But when I have this background of realization of coexistence, then when we are talking about work, we'll talk about the work in the context of entire nature, the context of nature as a whole. So when we are interacting with any particular unit in nature, we have all the way come down from our responsibility in work towards the nature as a whole. And therefore, when I'm interacting with any particular unit and ensuring this fulfillment, mutual enrichment in my work, I will at least not violate my relationship of mutual fulfillment with other units. So I may contribute to it, I may not contribute to it, but I will not violate these basic relationships. So now when I'm seeking work with nature, seeing work with nature in and around the family, I cannot violate my responsibility of mutual fulfillment towards the entire nature. But if I do not have the realization of coexistence, I might violate the nature which is not in the immediate vicinity. And this is happening, right? That you can see happening around most of our production systems. It seems to be such that when we are producing, there is no clarity about what will happen to the byproducts when it goes out of the factory. If it is dumped in the sea, or if it is dumped in that big mountain of garbage coming up in different parts of Delhi, we don't seem to be concerned about that. So with that clarity, that when I'm looking at work, I'm looking at work with the context of my relationship with the rest of nature, right? With the entire nature, the nature as a whole. And not only that particular immediate vicinity, but the immediate nature around us in the family or in this town. So now we will look at the same work with that perspective. So we are saying following is done with the perspective of work in the context of nature as a whole. So what we have to take care of is the same, which we have already discussed in last session. But now the perspective is of work in the context of nature as a whole, and not only that limited nature, that immediate environment. Similarly, participation in the larger order, if you look at that, we have talked about this human goal and the dimensions of human order and how we can ensure this fulfillment of this human goal through 5 dimensions of human order. And also we have talked about how this is scope. This we have talked about in UHP1 itself, that how we expand from family order toward family order. So that remains the same, so I'm not going into the detailed explanation. But what we will observe is that when we have the realization of coexistence, and with that, when we are participating in the family order, it will be in the context of participation in the 5 dimensions of universal human order for fulfillment of 4 human goals. So when I'm looking at my participation in my family order or the village order, right, I'm only not looking at my participation in the family order only or village order only. I'm presently participating there, but at the back of my mind or the base, I have this clarity of my participation in the 5 dimensions of universal human order, so that I can ensure the fulfillment of 4 human goals. So this will always be there, and with that, at the back of our mind, we may work out my immediate fulfillment of the participation in my family order or in the village order. So this is briefly about the behavior, the work, the participation in the larger order. So you can see that we have not defined the reality as something different, but what we are saying is the reality will remain the same, therefore the definition will remain the same. But we have tried to see what is our perspective when we are looking at behavior, when we are looking at work, when we are looking at participation. So think, reflect on it. With this, we can move on to this 3.7 to 3.9, that is undivided society, the universal human orders, and the human tradition. So when we have this realization of coexistence, understanding of harmony, and contemplation of relationship, then of course we will start seeing things with that wider perspective. And when we are seeing things with that wider perspective, then I can see this, the undivided human society, the universal human order, and ultimately the human tradition. So this undivided society is basically the expansion of human-human relationship to the whole nature, to the whole existence. So that is what we have written. Outcome of living with justice in harmony with human being from family to world family. So that expansion of your identity is what is important. That when we are looking at our relationship with other human being, right, it was restricted to the family, but that is not fulfilling completely. Therefore, we expand, and we expand right up to the world family order. And when we are able to respond, you know, be there, we can see that there is a complete fulfillment in the self. So we have to expand right up to the world family. And that is what we are calling as undivided society. We had also said that this feeling of love is what is at the base of this undivided human society, which means realization of coexistence is at the base of this undivided human society. So with realization of coexistence, understanding of harmony, contemplation of relationship, I can have the feeling of love. With that feeling of love, when I am working in the society, it will give rise to universal, give rise to undivided human society. So this undivided human society is a natural outcome of understanding or realization of coexistence. It is showing itself in the form of feeling of love and compassion. So this feeling of love for other human beings results into fulfillment of relationship with human being, with one, with many, and with all. And that gives rise to undivided human society. Similarly, if you look at the universal human order, this universal human order, it is five dimensions. Ensuring human goal is what we are calling as universal human order. An outcome of living in harmony in nature, right, in harmony with human being as well as the rest of nature, is what ensures universal human order. So I have to ensure this harmony at the level of nature, starting from family order to world family order. If I am able to do this, I am able to ensure this universal human order. So universal human order is anyway, you know, at the level of existence as a whole. And what I have to do is identify this participation in the five dimensions of the human order, which ensures the fulfillment of human goal, and fulfill that participation. So I may start with one unit, with one human being, but I have to have this expansion of my perception right up to the world family order. right up to the nature, right up to the existence. This also we have talked about, so I'm not going into the detail. I've just displayed it for the reminding. So with this, we can now come to this human tradition. Human tradition in which human goal is fulfilled, right? Generation after generation. So this we should talk in little more detail than what we have talked about in ESG1. In ESG2, we have not talked about human tradition till now. But we are purposely not doing it because this universal, the human tradition is an outcome of undivided society, the universal human order, with its continuity. But let us now talk about some aspect of this human tradition. So we are saying undivided human society and universal human order, its continuity from generation to generation. That is what human tradition is. And this is what will ensure the fulfillment of the need of human being for continuous happiness. What are the sequence in which human tradition can be materialized? So when we try to materialize this human tradition, right, the basic thing, of course, is having the realization of coexistence, the understanding of harmony, and the contemplation of the relationship. But when it comes to realizing this as a tradition, as a human tradition, which can meet out this requirement, when it comes to ensuring this tradition, this human tradition, in which we can ensure this fulfillment of human goals generation after generation, or in other words, we can ensure the continuity of undivided society in the universal human order. So let us look at that. And while looking at that, we can identify one possible sequence through which we can go to ensure this universal human order. And that sequence is human education, leading to human conduct, leading to human constitution, leading to human order. And this human order ensures that for the next generation, it is able to provide the human education. So this will be the cycle through which we can go to ensure the human tradition. But while mentioning this, we have put a footnote there saying that this is not the only sequence, there can be other sequences also. The main point there is that I know where I am standing and I know where I have to reach. So that goal is fixed. Then we take out time anyway for that. Yes, so this is one sequence that we will talk about. There are other sequences like human education leading to human sanskar, leading to human conduct, which is leading to human order. So there can be other sequences. But we will talk about this first sequence that we have mentioned. And let's look at that. What does it mean? So this diagram shows that if we have human education, then it gives rise to human conduct. Human conduct in the students who are going through this process of human education. And this human conduct will help us to see, to understand what will be the basic guidelines or basic form of people living together, people with right understanding and right conduct living together. And if we have such basic principles, then that is what we are calling as human constitution. Then this human constitution can contribute significantly in terms of human order. And you can also see that if there is human order, it will be able to provide human education and sanskar. So that is how the whole cycle will be completed. So we have this human education, education that ensures development of the competence to live with definite human conduct. If you remember, this is the first session, EHB1, first session on development, right? Holistic development. There you could see that what is required to ensure holistic development is to have the human education. And this human education, will be able to develop the competence of human being to live with that definite conduct. So if there is human education, it will lead to human conduct, that is conduct that ensures continuity of mutual fulfillment and prosperity. And this human conduct will help us to see the interrelationship between human beings and how it can be fulfilled. We can understand the participation of the human being in the larger context and how we can fulfill it. So that will be the constitution, the basic guideline for our living in, for our behavior, for our work, for our participation, starting from family order towards family order. And if I am working with this constitution, it will give rise to human order. It will give rise to a society in which human goal is realized generation after generation. And if we have such a human order, then it can provide and it will provide the human education to all. So this is the cycle of human tradition, and this is the direction in which things are moving or going to move. So now if you look at this whole cycle, and if we see that this condition is not there, is not prevailing, which you can easily see, then how do you go about? Where do we start? So if you look at that, then most convenient and most effective entry point could be the human education. The most convenient and most effective entry point could be the human education. So this is what we have to understand, that for human being, education is the most important activity. If we have the right education, we'll have the right conduct, the right constitution, right order. If we have inhuman education, we'll have inhuman conduct, inhuman constitution, and inhuman order. So this entry point is the education. If we can understand this, then we can see the importance of work that we are doing. So most of us fortunately are related with this education, right? Whether it is human or inhuman. And we have all the opportunity to provide education. And we are providing education to the children, right? So now we can see that our role is very important. Through education, we can make the desirable, you know, changes, desirable development in our family, in our institution, and finally in the society and the world family. So we, as teachers, as policymakers, are involved in education. Most of us directly, and some of us indirectly. So that opportunity is already there. Therefore, what we need to do is to see what we can do for education and in education with the given state of affairs. So that we should be able to see, that importance. Right? So reflect on this. When we are talking about our plan and program with this understanding, we will try you to identify these points and share. From our side, of course, we will kind of place some of the possible things that we can do in education. But this is the place where we can start working if we really want to work for human tradition. If we really want to become, you know, work for undivided society and universal human order and its continuity generation after generation. So if we ensure this human education, which will give rise to the human conduct and human constitution and finally the human order, in which the human education will be taken care of, you know, in future, then we are able to set this wheel rolling. And once this wheel starts rolling, though it may take time, but by its own, you know, kind of ongoing cyclic process, it will continue, and we may have one day the universal human order and its continuity, that is human tradition. So this is what we intended to place in this session. Of course, there are a lot of details that can be talked about when it comes to human tradition or undivided society and universal human order. But we have very briefly introduced it here. So if there are questions, there are any detailing required, we can certainly talk about it. So with this, let me introduce some of the points for reflection, and then we can open to question. So these few points for self-observation, self-reflection. Observe in your behavior. So when you are behaving with any human being, now we have to observe, what is the feeling at the base? Do we have the feeling of love at the base, and from there you are coming down to affection for a particular individual? Or is it otherwise? This evaluation we have to make. So every time we think of behavior and we have some feeling, you know, with one of my family members or one of my friends, let us ask ourselves, is there this feeling of love at the base, and as a particular implication of that feeling of love, you have the affection for this person, or otherwise? Similarly, when you are looking at work, what is at the focus? Mutual fulfillment with entire nature is at the base. And from there, you are coming down to mutual fulfillment with natural resources you are working with, or it is otherwise. So that change of emphasis is what we are trying to, you know, ask you to reflect on, work on in your day-to-day life. Similarly, when you are talking about the participation in the family order or village order and so on, ask this question to yourself, that participation in the universal human order is at the base. And from there, you are coming down to participation in the family order. Is that the case or otherwise? What is at the base? Participation in the universal human order, or participation in my family order only? So at the base has to be the participation in the universal human order. That universal human order which is defining the order in the whole nature of existence. So we like keep this mind, this participation in the universal human order. And then in the light of that, I will think as participation in the family order. Is that the case or otherwise is the case? That is, I think that my participation in this particular order is all that is there. And I cannot appreciate therefore that there are other areas where this participation is still possible for the universal human order. So just reflect on this. So with this, I will open to question regarding what we have discussed in this session. So welcome.
We have Akhilesh Verma ji and Man-